More than 120 people will die today in our country from gun violence. More than half will die by suicide using a gun, while the remainder will be victims of a gun-related homicide. Of those who die as a result of gun homicides, almost 60% will be Black men, even though they comprise only about 7% of the population in America. They will be fathers, mothers, brothers, sisters, children, grandchildren, who all leave behind grieving loved ones with gaping holes in their lives. My name is Dr. Joseph Richardson. I'm the Joel and Kim Feller Professor of African American Studies and Anthropology and an Empower Professor. I've spent most of my career studying the impact and cycle of gun violence and trauma, primarily among young Black men. I'm honored to be delivering this year's Beyond the Field Homecoming Address and share some of what I've learned from my decades of research. Some of the facts you learn today might be hard to hear, but that doesn't make them any less true. For instance, 100,000 people are shot every year in our country. Also, we have an estimated 393 million guns, meaning there are more guns than people. Avoiding facts like these and ignoring the problem is a major reason why gun violence is so prevalent in the United States and a uniquely American problem. Issues people choose to ignore because it's not in their backyard and it does not affect them will ultimately affect them at some point. You will know someone who has been injured or has died from a gunshot wound, whether it's through self-inflicted or it's through someone just randomly died at the hands of a bullet that may not have been intended for them. My research focuses primarily on survivors of firearm violence, and I use the two busiest trauma centers in the state of Maryland as my research labs. I'm tasked with understanding what are the risk factors that would bring someone into the hospital for a violent injury, and then more importantly, what are the risk factors that would bring them back a second, third, or fourth time? I use my research to develop and implement the Capital Region Violence Intervention Program, a hospital-based program at the University of Maryland Capital Region Health, and one of 40 hospital-based violence intervention programs in the world. HVIPs are designed to treat individuals who have suffered from a violent injury, and hopefully through the work of our violence intervention specialists and our trauma team, we can get them engaged in psychosocial services. So they would get therapy, job assistance to get employment, housing assistance, and also, and more importantly as well, legal assistance. What I've learned through my research about the cycle of gun violence is that up to 60% of all the individuals who have been shot, this may be their second, third, fourth time treated at a hospital for a violent injury. And many of the reasons why people come back to the hospital for a repeat violent injury are the result of structural factors, which often remain unaddressed in their communities. Many of the individuals who come into trauma units who have been shot are also suffering from other chronic diseases. Neighborhoods that have high rates of gun violence, which is considered a disease, also have high rates of other chronic diseases: diabetes, hypertension, heart disease, HIV and AIDS, that those chronic diseases also coexist with gun violence. If I were to get on the Red Line in Woodley Park, which is located in the upper northwest section of Washington, D.C., the life expectancy is 89 years. If I travel to Southeast D.C. and get off at Congress Heights, which is a poor, predominantly African-American community, the life expectancy is approximately 68 years. So in a matter of a metro ride, I lose 21 years of life expectancy in the nation's capital, in the richest country in the world. So in the same way that we approach other chronic diseases and urgently think about solutions, We should also approach gun violence in the same way. All of those clusters of red, they represent human beings, and they represent families and neighborhoods and children who live underneath those dots in those neighborhoods. You can look at that map and become very desensitized to those dots. And those dots represent individuals who have either died or have been injured by a gunshot wound. My job is to really explain to the public what those dots mean, to humanize those dots, because in your world, or many people who are outside of that world, they're just dots. And my goal is to reduce the number of dots on that map so at some point in time, we may not have any dots on that map at all. There are so many upstream issues which lead to gun violence, whether it's the concentration of poverty, poor housing, under-resourced schools, hyper-policing in communities of color. All of these things culminate to produce gun violence. And I think people believe that someone grabs a gun, they're angry, they go out and shoot someone. But actually, that's not the way that gun violence plays out. Gun violence is the result of all of the other conditions that lead up to interpersonal violence. So it's not a war that we're going to wage specifically against the gun. And so I urge people to just get out of their comfort zone, to acknowledge that it's an American-made problem. The responsibility is for every American to prevent the next person from being shot. There should be no reason why 120 people die from gun violence every day. There should be no reason why 100,000 people are shot every year. There's no reason why we're spending billions of dollars to take care of people who have been shot and suffer from a gunshot wound and the long-term consequences of it. Please get out of your comfort zone, because ultimately the problem that you choose to ignore today will be on your doorstep. So I would like to thank everyone for listening. I hope you've learned something today, and I hope that you leave inspired.